When they stood within hearing, Arioios said, "Listen, Greeks. Clearchus was shown to have perjured himself and broken the truce. Therefore he has been punished and he is dead. You lay down your arms. That is the king's demand." The Greeks made Cleonor their spokesman to answer, and he said, "You abominable wretch, Arioios, and you others who were friends of Cyrus, have you no shame before gods and men? You swore the oath to have the same friends and enemies as we did, and you have betrayed us. You have murdered the very man to whom you gave your oath, and you have betrayed us all, and you join our enemies to come against us." The barbarians discussed this for a long time, and then went away without answering a word. The captains, captured thus, were carried up to the king, and there beheaded. One of them, Clearchus, was a true soldier, and war was his passion, as all agreed who formed their opinions from personal knowledge. As long as the war lasted between Lacedaemon and Athens, he stayed at home. But when peace came, he persuaded his own city that the Thracians were injuring the Greeks. And having managed as well as he could with the Aphors, he managed to make war on the Thracians beyond Chersonese and Perinthus. However, the Aphors changed their minds as soon as he had set out, and tried to turn him back from the Isthmus. But he would not obey them any longer, and sailed away to the Hellespont. Consequently, he was sentenced to death by the Spartan government for disobedience to orders. He was already a banished man when he came to Cyrus. What arguments he used to persuade Cyrus have been written elsewhere. At least Cyrus gave him 10,000 darics. He took the money, but he did not turn to a lazy life. No, with this money he collected a force and made war on the Thracians and conquered them in battle. He ravaged them after that, and went on with the war until Cyrus wanted his army. Then he went off to make war again under him. These seem to me the doings of a man whose passion was war. When he could have kept at peace without shame or damage, he chose war. When he could have been idle, he wished for hard work that he might have war. When he could have kept wealth without danger, he chose to make it less by making war. This was a man who spent upon war as if it were a darling lover or some other pleasure. So, war was his passion, and he seemed a true soldier because he loved perils, ready to lead against the enemy by day or by night, and he kept his head in danger, as those with him agreed one and all in every place. He had also the repute of a true leader as far as was possible for a man of his character. And he was able to fix firmly in their minds that Clearchus must be obeyed. This he did by being severe. He was grim to look at and harsh in voice. He punished heavily and sometimes in anger, so that now and again he was sorry for it. And he punished on principle, for he thought an unpunished army was good for nothing. Indeed, he used to say that a soldier ought to fear his commander more than the enemy if he was to keep guard or keep his hand off friends or attack the enemy without excuses. In danger, however, the soldiers wished absolutely to obey him and chose no other. At such times, his grimness appeared brightness, they said. His severity seemed strength against the enemy, so that they thought it salvation rather than severity. But when the danger was past, many left him if there was an opportunity to pass over to other commanders. For he had no charm, and he was always severe and cruel. So the soldiers felt towards him as boys towards a schoolmaster. Indeed, he never found any to follow him for affection and friendship. But those who were put under his charge by some authority, or through need or some other constraint, he found completely obedient. But when they began to succeed in conquering an enemy under him, his men had strong motives to make them useful. For one thing, they felt confident of victory, and for another, They feared punishment from him, which made them obedient. Such was Clearchus as a commander, but it was said he did not like very much to be commanded himself. He was about 50 years old when he died.